Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Welcome, 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 one and all, to the Wednesday night Berean Bible study here at Cross Covenant Ministries of Christ. We are ever so grateful to each and every last one of you for taking time out of your very busy day, or maybe at this point, very busy night, to spend just a little bit of time with us. We truly thank God for laying it up on your heart to join us in drawing nearer unto Him and getting to know Him for who He is and coming to love Him, not just for what He can do for us, amen, but for also, but moreover, for who He is, praise God, because He is wonderful, praise God. He is beautiful, praise God. He is the God who is love. He is our counselor, praise God. He is the one who sticketh closer to us than any brother, praise God. When our mother or father, or you know, if our mother or father were to forsake us, praise God, He would never leave us. He would never forsake us, praise God. He has been with us from the very beginning of time, praise God. He is the very one who breathed the breath of life into us, and we became living souls, praise God. So on tonight, praise God, if you would please be so kind as to join me in standing in awe of one so great, to go before the Lord of Lords, to go before the King of Kings, hallelujah, praise God, to worship Him, praise God, to worship the one who is the Most High, to worship the one who is most holy, praise God, because He loved us, praise God, while we were yet dead in our sins, and He loves us still, no matter what bit of selfishness, no matter how much of our selfishness that we cling onto, He loves us, praise God, in spite of it all, praise God, hallelujah, hallelujah. And even yet today, praise God, the Spirit and the Bride say, come, praise God, hallelujah. Come unto Him, all of those of us who labor and are heavy laden, praise God. If we will but learn of Him, praise God, He will give us rest for our weary souls, praise God. Praise God, hallelujah, hallelujah. He will break every burden. He will remove every yoke if we will but say yes to the Lord Jesus. Praise God. Not just one time, mind you, okay? Sanctification is an ongoing process, okay? So we are to continue to say yes to the Lord Jesus. We are to continue to deny our own selfishness, to become disciples of Christ, praise God. That is what it means to truly be a Christian. We are to deny our own selfishness, our own way of doing things. Praise God, for His thoughts are higher than our thoughts, and His ways are higher than our ways. Praise God. And we are to cleave unto the Lord Jesus, cleave unto the agape. In other words, take up the way of the cross. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And it is at that point that we are enabled by His grace. Praise God, the divine influence of God upon the heart being revealed into our lives. Praise God, it is at that point that we are enabled to follow after Him, to follow after love. Hallelujah, praise God. All right, so we're gonna go before the Lord of Lords and King of Kings. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Heavenly Father, Your word says, oh God, that we are to enter into Your courts with thanksgiving and into Your gates with praise, oh God. Hallelujah, Jesus. So we come on this night, oh Lord God, to worship You, to stand in awe of You, oh Lord God, to reverence You in this place, oh God. We come to sing Your praises, oh Lord God. Hallelujah, Jesus. Because Your word says that You inhabit the praises of Your people. Hallelujah. That is why, hallelujah, when praises go up, the blessings come down, because You are our exceeding great reward. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah. If You never do another thing for any one of us, oh Lord God, You have already done more than enough. You have already done more than we could ever deserve, oh Lord God. And we worship you in this place, oh God. In the mighty name of Jesus, we cry, holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty. Hallelujah. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty. Hallelujah. Thank you, Thou art truly the one who was and is to come. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And oh, Most High, we look forward to that great and precious day, oh Lord God. That amazing promised day when we may look upon the face of the lover of our souls, hallelujah, and the lifter up of our heads, oh Lord God, hallelujah, the one who has kept us and protected us all these years, oh Lord God, even when we could have died so many times. In our very mother's womb, oh Lord God, you looked over us, oh Lord God. In our wayward ways, oh Lord God, traversing the highways and the byways, in the nightclubs and in the drug houses and all kinds of filth and degradation, oh Lord God, you washed over us, oh God. It was you and you alone who has kept us thus far, oh Lord God. And we come on this night to worship you. We thank you, O Lord God, that even in the midst of the wilderness, O Lord God, as the children of Israel, O Lord God, asked to do, we go forth even in the wilderness to worship you, O Lord God. Because despite our failure, despite our circumstance, despite our situation, O Lord God, you are God alone. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And we worship you, O God. We worship you in this place, O Lord God, because it is only by thy grace, it is only by thy mercy that we are not consumed. Heavenly Father, in the mighty name of Jesus, O Lord God, though we be as pilgrims in this land, O Lord God, foreigners traversing this land, O Lord God, we are encamped round about by evil on every side, O Lord God. As we live day to day in this Luciferian society, O Lord God, as the God, little g, of this earth, O Lord God, seeks to devour all that he can, O God. Yet and still, in the midst of it all, you draw us with an everlasting love. You lift out your everlasting hand, O Lord God. You pick us up even in the very depths of our hell here on this earth, O Lord God. It is you and you alone. Thank you, Father. Nobody, nobody but Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Oh, precious majesty, you said in your word in the 23rd Psalm, O Lord God. Hallelujah. It is the Lord who is my shepherd. I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. Hallelujah. Nobody, nobody but Jesus. Hallelujah. When I had nothing, oh God, when I was dying in my own waste, oh Lord God, and left all alone, oh Lord God, in my sin. You reached out and you loved me still. And I owe you everything. I owe you everything. I thank you, Lord Jesus. I thank you. And I reverence you in this place, oh God, in the mighty name of Jesus, Heavenly Father. For all of those, oh God, who are as we were, lost and alone, without knowing, without a true relationship with the Savior, oh God. Heavenly Father, help us to let our light so shine to let the light of the glorious gospel of truth, the glorious gospel of peace, the glorious gospel of love shine forth through us, O Lord God, that it might touch those who are drowning in darkness, O Lord God, those who are in desperate need of your love and in desperate need of a rhema word from on high, in desperate need, O Lord God, of a touch, just one touch from you. Heavenly Father, in the mighty name of Jesus, we ask you on this night, O Lord God, as yielded and surrendered vessels, that you would touch through us, O Lord God, in the name of Jesus. That you would speak through us, O Lord God, in the name of Jesus, O Lord God. That you would love through us, O Lord God, in the name of Jesus, O Lord God. In the mighty name of Jesus, O Lord God, let your healing rivers flow. In the mighty name of Jesus, O Lord God, out of our bellies, O Lord God, because we believe upon you according to the truth of your word, O Lord God, let the rivers of life flow forth, O God. In the mighty name of Jesus, O Lord God, speak, Lord. Thy servants shall hear thee. In the mighty name of Jesus, we ask on this night, O God, that you would make my tongue as the pen of the ready writer, O God. In the mighty name of Jesus, O Lord God, give to me the tongue of the learned, O God, that I may know how to speak a word in season to he who is weary. In the mighty name of Jesus, I surrender my tongue. In the mighty name of Jesus, I surrender my heart. In the mighty name of Jesus, I surrender my hands. In the mighty name of Jesus, I surrender my mind, O Lord God. In the mighty name of Jesus, I surrender my all. I lay it all onto the altar of sacrifice that I may decrease abundantly so. Because you must needs increase abundantly so in me. I need you to increase abundantly so in me. In the mighty name of Jesus. Heavenly Father, please cause the love of God to be shed abroad in our hearts by the precious gift of the wondrous Holy Ghost. In the mighty name of Jesus, send forth a rhema word from on high, O Lord God. Order our steps in your word, O Lord God. Let your word ever be a lamp unto our feet and a light unto our path, O God. Even send forth the wonderful Spirit of truth to lead and guide us into all truth, because we need you. You are the very source of our life, O Lord God. And we're desperate for you. In Jesus' name, this we ask and we pray according to your word, which is the only truth and is no lie, O God. In the mighty name of Jesus, we agree and we say, amen, amen, amen. Amen. Praise God. Praise God, praise God, praise God, praise God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You know, once you have the great opportunity to get to know him, he is so wonderful.
Amen.
Praise God. When you start to praise him, praise God, sometimes it's hard to stop because he is so deserving of it all.
Amen.
Praise God. He is so deserving. And he is so wonderful and so magnificent. Praise God.
Amen.
He is ever faithful. Praise God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. All right. Praise God. So on this night, praise God, we're going to go forth in the message entitled Seduced by the Spirit of Error. Okay. So again, that is Seduced by the Spirit of Error.
Amen.
Praise God. All right. So, of course, if you would please be so kind, we're going to start off on tonight in the great book of Genesis, chapter 1, verses 26 through 27. Again, that's the great book of Genesis, chapter 1, starting at the 26th verse. When you have it, please be so kind as to say amen.
Amen.
Okay. I'm sorry. Praise God for the amens. All right. So, the great word of God does read, and God said, let us make man in our image, after our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, and over the fowl of the air, and over the cattle, and over all the earth, and over every creeping thing that creepeth upon the earth. So God created man in his own image. In the image of God created he him, male and female created he them. Okay, praise God. So we understand, praise God, that the Lord created us, praise God, according to his physical likeness as well as spiritual likeness, praise God. So when we were initially created, we were in unison and on one accord, praise God, with the perfect mind of God, praise God. So we were created, as it were, in the faith, praise God. All right, and of course, also herein, we see that the Lord created the marriage union, and we know that the Lord created the marriage union to give him glory, praise God, and to also show forth to others the beauty of his love, praise God. Now, unfortunately, most marriages in this day and age, because of the fall of man and the selfishness that is so inherent in the heart of man and woman alike, okay, most marriages do not show forth his glory and do not bring him praise, but that was his intention, praise God. So the Lord created the marriage union in that he made two to be agreed in the bond of unity and love, praise God, because he is the God who is love and he is the great amen, praise God. All right, so continuing forth in Genesis chapter 2, starting at the 15th verse. Again, that's the great book of Genesis chapter 2, starting at verse 15. When you have it, please be so kind as to say amen.
Amen.
All right, praise God for the amens. All right, and the Lord God took the man and put him into the Garden of Eden to dress it and to keep it. Okay, so he put them there for a specific purpose, praise God. All right, they were there to be about the Father's business, to guard over the provision that they had been given, to cultivate it, praise God, into that which would bring forth more glory unto the Heavenly Father, praise God. All right, and the Lord God commanded the man, saying, of every tree of the garden thou mayest freely eat, but of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil thou shalt not eat of it, for in the day that thou eatest thereof, thou shalt surely die, okay? So we understand that out of love, praise God, the commandment was given. Literally, the commandment was given in love by the God who is love.
Amen.
Praise God, all right? Yet his love, unfortunately, as we all know the story, was rejected, okay? Due to the selfishness of man, or the selfish choice of man, okay? Of course, Adam and Eve rebelled against the commandment of God, even against the very word of God. And the Apostle Paul confirms for us what still happens every time sin or selfishness shows up, okay? Even the encouragement of that spirit of error. Okay, so let's go over to the great book of Romans, chapter 7. We're going to start with verse number 7. Again, that's the great book of Romans, chapter 7, starting with verse number 7. And when you have it, please be so kind as to say amen.
Amen.
Praise God for the amens. All right, so now the great word of God does read, what shall we say then? Is the law sin? God forbid, okay? So he clarifies for us that though the commandment was given by God, okay, it was not sin, okay? So the law was not there to produce selfishness,
amen.
Okay? So he says, God forbid, nay, I had not known sin but by the law. So he says, okay, so the Lord gave us the commandment. Okay, he gave us the commandment, he gave us the law so that we would recognize sin, okay? All right, we will recognize selfishness and what it was, okay? All right, so he says, For I had not known lust, except the law had said, thou shalt not covet. Okay? But sin, taking occasion by the commandment. So the selfishness in me took occasion by the commandment, wrought in me all manner of concupiscence. Okay? So just all manner of uncontrolled lust and sin, okay? For without the law, sin was dead, okay? So without the law, I did not recognize, without the commandment that the Lord gave, I did not recognize what the sin or selfishness was, okay? For I was alive without the law once, but when the commandment came, sin or selfishness revived and I died, okay? So once I received the commandment, you know, due to my own selfishness, I made a choice based on my own personal perception, based on my own personal preferences, as Pastor Harris has shared in times past, based on my own personal desires, okay? So I followed the way of error as opposed to the way of truth, all right? So he says, but when the commandment came, sin revived and I died, and the commandment which was ordained to life, okay? So he says, you know, this commandment was given by love to give me life. Praise God. It was going to give him enlightenment. It was going to give him understanding of a thing, okay? But, instead, he says, I found to be unto death. Okay? So the Lord gave it to bring forth life, okay? Just like the Lord gave the commandment to Adam and Eve to preserve their life, they had freedom of choice, as Pastor Harris has said time and again, okay? They had total freedom of choice, as the Word of God tells us in Genesis chapter 2 and verse 16. And the Lord God commanded the man, saying, of every tree of the garden thou mayest freely eat. So of every tree of the garden, including this tree, you have the right, you have the choice to eat it, okay? But here's the commandment of the Lord. But verse 17, but of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, thou shalt not eat of it, for in the day that thou eatest thereof, thou shalt surely die. Okay? So it was given, the commandment was given as a means of protection. Okay? It was given by love to bring forth life, to protect the life that the Lord God himself had given. All right? But continuing forth in Romans chapter 7 and verse number 11. For sin, taking occasion by the commandment, deceived me, and by it slew me. And what does what is it that Eve said in the garden? She said that the serpent beguiled her. He deceived her. Okay? All right. So he says, sin taking occasion by the commandment deceived me, and by it slew me. Wherefore the law is holy. Okay, so the commandment of God is holy. Praise God. And what is the word of God? The word of God gives us the commandments of the Lord. Okay, so the word of God is holy. Praise God. All right. So wherefore the law is holy, and the commandment holy, and just and good. Okay? Was then that which is good made death unto me? God forbid. So he says, don't misunderstand and think that that which was good was made death unto me. Okay? So he says, God forbid. But it was sin. So the selfishness is what turned it into that which it into error. Okay? As opposed to what the Lord intended it to be. Praise God. All right. So was God forbid, but sin that it might appear sin working death in me by that which is good, that sin by the commandment might become exceeding sinful, so that he can truly understand how awful this thing was. Praise God. For we know that the law is spiritual, but I am carnal, okay? We're fleshly and worldly, okay? Sold under sin. King David said, I was born in sin. I was born in selfishness. Praise God. And I was shaped in iniquity. I was shaped by unjust judgment. I was shaped by the world system, by the Luciferian society that surrounds me. Okay? And so the Apostle Paul says, I am carnal, sold under sin. For that which I do, I allow not. Okay? For what I would, that do I not. But what I hate, that do I. Okay? So right here where he says that he was sold under sin, you know, it almost carries with it the same connotation, just like Esau, who sold his birthright to Jacob for the satisfaction of his belly. Okay? So the birthright did not mean anything to him. Just like evidently Adam and Eve were ungrateful for all the provision that the Lord had given unto them, okay? And due to their own selfishness, all of mankind was sold under sin, okay? We were sold because of their selfish desires, because of the lust of their eyes, because of the lust of their flesh, because of the pride of life. And we don't try to, you know, look down upon them as though, you know, they are something that is that are just so far-fetched, because many of us have done the same, okay? Maybe not the exact same scenario, of course, but but many of us, all of us have sinned and come short of the glory of God, okay? Verse 15, for that which I do, I allow not. For what I would, that do I not. But what I hate, that do I. And I'm sure that all of us have this testimony, okay? If then I do that which I would not, I consent unto the law that it is good, okay? So he says he can see the law itself working within him, okay? So even though he will know that something is, or even though we will know that something is wrong, okay, we are still ever encouraged by our own selfishness and by, you know, the spirits of error that are all round about us, okay? We are ever encouraged to make the selfish choice, okay? The Satanists say, you know, do as thou wilt, okay? It's not about what the will of the Lord is, okay? But the Lord admonishes us to be like the Lord Jesus. Not my will, but thine, O Lord, okay? That is the image that we are being created and conformed into. That is the image that we are to be, I should say, created and conformed into, is the image of the Son of the living God. Praise God. And not the image of Lucifer, of this world system around us, okay? All right, so continuing forward, he says, if then I do that which I would not, I consent unto the law that it is good. Now then, it is no more I that do it, but sin or selfishness that dwelleth in me. Okay, that ETH means it continues there, okay? So it's consistent. Sin or selfishness that dwelleth in me, for I know that in me, that is in my flesh, okay? And this is a testament for us all, dwelleth no good thing. Amen. For to will is present with me, but how to perform that which is good, I find not, you see? So this speaks of self-seduction, okay? Our sin nature in us seduces us, into the way of error, okay? It is not just the spirits around us from without, okay? We cannot blame it all on the devil. It was not all the devil, okay? Because we had to agree. There was nothing that he could have done to us or through us or in us, okay, without our permission, okay? The Lord may have allowed him to test us, but we had to agree with that test. Just like Adam and Eve, Eve in the garden, you know, after that the Lord told them that this was the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, when, once they received the doctrine of the serpent or the doctrine of the dragon, okay, they perceived, their perception was changed into believing that this was good for food, okay, that this would bring nourishment to their bodies, nourishment to their souls, okay? And that was yet another deception and lie of the enemy, okay? All right. Now, continuing forward, so the Apostle Paul here says, he says, "For I know that in me, that is in my flesh, dwelleth no good thing. For to will is present with me, but how to perform that which is good I find not." Okay, so within our own selves, okay, we don't have a way to perform that which is good, okay? The most that we can do is to surrender unto the one who is good. Praise God.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. All right, so he says, "For the good that I would, I do not, but the evil which I would not, that I do. Now, if I do that I would not, it is no more I that do it, but sin or selfishness that dwelleth in me." And this, of course, does not negate personal responsibility, okay? So please don't go and allow anyone to twist the word of God. This is not saying that we just could not help ourselves. No. We taught for several months, praise God, from the book of Joshua, chapter 24, okay, verses 14 and 15, "Choose you this day whom you will serve," okay, all right? So the Lord gave us the choice from the very beginning, as we just read, okay, in the great book of Genesis, okay? We have always had freedom of choice, okay? Now, if we choose to fulfill our own selfish desires, then that responsibility is indeed not on God, but on us. Okay, this is why God, the Lord, does not send anybody to hell. We choose to go. Okay, all right, so he says, "I find then a law that when I would do good, evil is present with me." Okay, the sin nature in us is the nature of evil, okay, and it is in perfect unity with the spirit of error, okay, and with the Luciferian society that surrounds us every day. "For I delight in the law of God after the inward man." Okay? He says, "I love the word of God. But I see another law in my members, warring against the law of my mind." Okay? So we understand, as we've discussed time and again, the battleground there is in the mind. Okay? "And bringing me into captivity to the law of sin, which is in my members." Okay, so we understand that if we were continue forward into Romans chapter 8, verse 1 there, verses 1 through 3, we see that there is a law of sin and death.
Amen.
Okay, so he says, "Bringing me into captivity to the law of sin, which is in my members." Okay. So we have to understand that those two are connected, okay? The law of sin and death, that's why that "and" is there, is a conjunction to connect the two, because sin, selfishness, a selfish lifestyle leads to death.
Amen.
It leads to death and destruction, okay? There is but one place for it to go,
Amen.
Okay? Now, but then there's also, glory be to God, another law, praise God, in Romans chapter 8 and verses 1 through 3 there. It is the law of the spirit of life in Christ Jesus,
Hallelujah.
Okay? And that is the law that we need, okay?
Thank you, Lord.
That is the law that we need, and that is the only law that can save us, praise God, from the law of the spirit of, from the law of sin and death. All right? And then he says here in verse 24, O wretched man that I am, who shall deliver me from the body of this death? Okay? And then he says, I thank God through Jesus Christ our Lord. Praise God. So then with the mind I myself serve the law of God, but with the flesh the law of sin. Okay? This is why we have to bring our flesh into subjection. Amen. Praise God. We have to mortify the lust of the flesh. Excuse me. And surrender ourselves unto God. We have to deny our selfishness. Deny ourselves if we want to be disciples of Christ. Okay? And take up the cross. Praise God. Take up the way of the cross, the agape of God. Learn to love the Lord our God with all our hearts and minds and bodies and strength and everything, and love our neighbor as we love ourselves. Praise God. All right? We must take up the agape. Take up the way of the cross. This is the only way that we can truly follow after love. Praise God. Amen. Please go with me over to the great book of 1 John chapter 4. Verses, and we're going to start at the first verse. Again, that's 1 John chapter 4, starting at verse number 1. When you have it, please be so kind as to say amen.
Amen.
Okay, so now as we've just discussed, there is a spiritual war going on. Praise God. We are definitely at war. There is no denying that, okay? And the battlefield is in the mind, but it is for the heart. Praise God. Again, that battlefield is in the mind, but it is for the heart, okay? Who will be seated on the throne of our heart? Praise God. All right, so 1 John chapter 4 and verse number 1 does read, Beloved, believe not every spirit, but try the spirits, whether they are of God, okay? Because many false prophets are gone out into the world. You see, the word of God warns us. Many false prophets are gone out into the world, okay? And these false prophets, as agents of the enemy, promote, praise God, the doctrine of demons, okay? Doctrines of devils, the doctrines of demons, as Pastor Harris shared with us on this past Sunday, okay? So he says, hereby know ye the Spirit of God. The Word of God, the Lord always comes to give us warning first, okay? He always comes to give us warning first, and then he gives us the opportunity by his love to make a choice. Amen. Praise God. And if we will seek his face and surrender, he will give us the abundance of grace. That divine influence, okay, upon our heart, working with, within us, both the will and the to-do of the good pleasure of God. But we have to surrender, you see. He will not force it upon us, okay? All right, so he says, hereby know ye the Spirit of God. Every spirit that confesses, that continues to confess that Jesus Christ is come in the flesh is of God. And every spirit that confesseth not that Jesus Christ is come in the flesh is not of God. Okay? And this is that spirit of Antichrist. You see, the Jews in the times of old, they didn't accept the Lord Jesus as being God. They did not accept, they rejected him as being their coming Messiah, their coming Redeemer, you see. And this is Antichrist because what it does is it helps to set the stage for the coming Antichrist, okay? They're still looking and waiting for, the Savior to come, you see. And this is why, because they rejected light, they will be so easily deceived, okay? And the same holds true for the rest of us. So he says, and this is that spirit of Antichrist, whereof ye have heard that it should come. And even now already is it in the world, okay? So we have been warned several thousands and thousands of years ago, okay? He says, and it was thus that spirit of Antichrist was in the world even then, okay? He says, ye are of God, little children, and have overcome them, because greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. They are of the world, therefore speak they of the world, and the world heareth them. We are of God, he that knoweth God heareth us. He that is not of God heareth not us, okay? So those who reject the word of God, okay? He says, hereby know we the spirit of truth and what? And the spirit of error. Amen. Okay? So we have to recognize that this world has in it only one spirit of truth, okay? The word of God tells us in the great book of St. John, okay, that when the spirit of truth comes, and he has come, okay, when the spirit of truth comes, he will leadeth and guideth us into all truth, okay? In other words, he will ever lead us and ever guide us into knowing the one who is the truth, the way, and the life, that is the Lord Jesus, okay? That is what the spirit of truth does. He helps us to behold and to examine the Lamb. Excuse me. Praise God. That is what the spirit of truth does. His conversation is all about the Lamb of God. Praise God. Okay. Just like, as we've read here in times past, praise God, the conversation in heaven is all about the Lamb of God. Praise God. It's all about the Lord Jesus, okay? The Christ, okay? We've read here time and again, okay, in the great book of Luke chapter 24, time and again how that the Lord Jesus told us that it is all about him. He said, starting at the book of Psalms, okay, in the book of Proverbs and all the prophets, okay? All right? All the Psalms spoke of him. It is written of him. In the great book of Hebrews, chapter 10, verse 7, I believe, he says, lo, I come in the volume of the book to do thy will, O God. Okay? So we understand that it's all about him. And the Holy Spirit of truth is the revealer of the Christ. Amen. Okay? He is the revealer of the anointed one of God, of the covenant God. So his conversation reveals to us the truth and the knowledge of the word of God. He leadeth. He continues. He ever leads us, and he guideth. He ever guides us into knowing, into the knowledge of the truth. Praise God. Okay. But then also, just as Satan has a copycat for everything for the things of God, okay, there is also that spirit of error, okay? There is also that spirit of error, and that spirit of error would lead us and guide us into all things regarding darkness, okay, and evil, and those things that are anti-Christ, okay? So it leadeth and guideth us into that which is the polar opposite of the truth, okay? So he says here in verse number 7, he says, beloved, let us love one another, for love is of God. And everyone that loveth, that continues to love, is born of God. Continues to walk in the way of the agape, praise God, that lives a lifestyle of love, and knoweth God, okay? He that loveth not God knoweth not God. He that loveth not knoweth not God, for God is love. Praise God. So the spirit of truth leadeth and guideth us into the way of love. Praise God. But the spirit of error leadeth and guideth us into the way of, hate and evil and suffering, okay? For instance, there are those that would testify, things like in the church of Satanism, okay, how that the Just like for the Christian, you know, the old hymns and everything, Amazing Grace, how sweet the sound, and the Lord Jesus, you know, Jesus loves me, this I know, and, you know, and all the wonderful hymns of old, you know, for us, that holds a special place in our hearts, and we, you know, use it as a form of worship. But for them, they torture children to those songs. So that it brainwashes them into hating, you know, when that type of worship comes up, okay? You know, it's something that's groomed into them, okay? They have these children that they call breeders, you know. Their only purpose for being born is, you know, for sacrifice, for torture, you know, for all kinds of just wicked and evil. I mean, can you imagine being one of those children? I mean, you know, if that doesn't make you grateful for, you know, how you grew up, if assuming that you did not grow up in that type of situation, okay, I don't know what would, because, I mean, that is pure evil, okay? These poor innocent children constantly being sacrificed, constantly being tortured in the name of the fake God of this world. Okay, I mean, you know, just and they do that. They take anything that is of God and twist it and pervert it to where those you know, to where it would, if those children do actually make it to adulthood, you know, they would be desensitized. Okay, just like the scripture talks about your conscience being seared, they would be desensitized to the spirit, the moving and operation of the spirit upon that worship. You know, I mean, you know, as I was going through some studies, I mean, that just absolutely broke my heart, you know, just to see the depth of cruelty, you know, to see how truly sinful sin and selfishness truly is, okay? But this is the world that we live in, okay? They are being guided by that spirit of error, okay? But we as children of God, as children of light, are to be guided ever by the spirit, the Holy Spirit of truth, okay? And this is what actually takes us into this situation that we find in the great book of 1 Timothy chapter 4, starting at verse number 1. We're going to go over there and take a look. Pastor Harris went through this on this past Sunday. Again, that's the great book of 1 Timothy chapter 4, starting at the first verse. When you have it, please be so kind as to say amen. Okay. And, I mean, we just, you know, the Word of God admonishes us to pray without ceasing. And, saints, we just really need to pray, you know, as Pastor Harris shared with us some of the statistics, over 800 thousand children, you know, missing every year, not even counting the ones who are the millions of children that are aborted, okay? And even those people who get into these evil, wicked lifestyles, you know, in Satanism and all kinds of evil things, you know, it is, you know, even often homosexuality and things of that nature. Once those bondages get these people, when they try to leave, you know, they are attacked. Some of them are killed, you know. And of course, they don't put that kind of stuff in the news about how, you know, the ones that actually got killed were actually killed by those in their same sect, you know, those who are living that homosexual lifestyle. You know, they blame it on the heterosexual people. They're the ones that killed them. No, most of it is the actual homosexuals themselves, because of people trying to get free, you know. And even some of those who are bound by things like Satanism and Luciferian societies, you know, I was listening to a testimony about a lady, you know, who had gone into the church. They came, the witches and things came in the church, drug her out of the church to beat and abuse her and you know, and torture her because she was trying to go to the Lord. You know, I mean, we have underground churches and all kinds of things all over the world. I mean, saints, we need to pray. You know, we need to pray without ceasing. We do, because we are being seduced on every side. We live, you know, and it's hard to believe, you know, because we grow up and we think it's normal. You know, we think these things are normal, but they're not. You know, we live in a Luciferian society, a society that promotes Satan worship. It promotes, you know, all manner of evil and concupiscence and just wickedness. Okay? Saints, we need to pray. We need to pray. And we need to bind the spirit of error. Okay? We need to bind these seducing spirits, okay? Because the word of God tells us that all that's left in the world is lust of the eye, the lust of the flesh, and the pride of life. That's all that's here. And the vast majority of us are fighting and cleaving with all that we have to hold on to it. You know, we need to pray because we are bound by darkness. Okay? We need to run into the arms of the Lord Jesus, okay? We need to run into the name of Jesus because the name of Jesus is a strong tower. The righteous run into it. Those who choose his way run into him and they are saved. Okay? He has promised that if we will, you know, confess our sins, if we will repent and return back unto God, praise God, he will hear from heaven. He will heal our land, okay? Praise God. That's why the word of God gives us warning, okay? With a temptation, he always gives us a way out, okay? There is but one way, though. Okay, do not believe the lies, okay, all this stuff on Oprah and all these other places and stuff, okay, many roads unto God. There is but one way, okay, there is but one Lord, one Spirit, the Holy Spirit, okay, there's but one good Spirit, I'll say it that way, praise God, the Holy Spirit of love, praise God. Amen. And he is our only hope, praise God. We must go back unto the Lord Jesus. All right, but we're warned in 1 Timothy chapter 4, starting at the first verse, the great word of God does tell us, now the Spirit speaketh expressly, okay? The word expressly here, the Greek word for that is rhetos, okay? It means outspokenly, distinctly, okay? So the Lord is telling us, praise God, at every opportunity that he can, okay, he's warning us, okay, he's speaking distinctly, and this word rhetos actually comes from, the Greek word, let's see, it's an adverb from a derivative of the Greek word rio, okay, which means to pour forth words, to express, okay? All right? So that gives the connotation of passion, of love, okay? He's telling us and warning us, praise God, with all that he has, praise God, because he's a good God. He is the God that is love. Now, he says that in the latter times, some shall depart from the faith, giving heed, okay? And this Greek word heed is proseko, okay? And it means to hold the mind towards, okay? It means to pay attention to be cautious about, to apply oneself to adhere to, okay? So he says, in the latter times, some shall depart from the faith, giving heed, okay? They're going to be holding their mind towards seducing spirits. Okay? The word here for seducing is the Greek word planos. As we've discussed this one before, it means straying or wandering from the straight path. We just discussed a moment ago, there is but one way to God. Okay? The word of God tells us no man goes to the Father but by the Lord Jesus. No man. Okay? And anyone who tries is but a thief and a robber, you see. Okay? But it says these seducing spirits, they come to make us stray or wander from the straight path. Roving as a stray dog or as a vagabond. Okay? They are imposters and misleaders. These are seducing spirits. Okay? And doctrines, those are teachings, as Pastor Harris shared, teachings of devils or demons, as Pastor Harris shared with us. Now, what are doctrines, what are doctrines of devils and demons? Let's look at the great book of James, chapter 3. We're going to start at verse 15. Again, that's the great book of St. James, chapter 3, starting at the 15th verse. When you have it, please be so kind as to say amen.
Amen.
Oh, praise God for the amens.
Amen.
All right. So the great word of God does read, "This wisdom descendeth not from above, but is earthly," okay, it's carnal, fleshly, all right, sensual. The Greek word here for sensual is psychikos. Excuse me, I'm not probably not saying that right. Psychikos, all right, and it means properly soulish, pertaining to the soul, okay? It means that which is motivated and controlled through the soul. It means worldly, focused on the natural senses, the world and internal motivations, various instincts, needs, and wants. By extension, it is natural, sensual, as directly opposed to spiritual. Okay? So now it says here, you know, so pretty much the doctrines of devils and demons will encourage us in the way of those things that attract the natural senses of man, that adhere to our own selfish desires, our own selfish lusts, okay? So this is one of the ways that we can tell, praise God, that this is a doctrine of demons and devils, not a doctrine of truth, not the doctrine of Christ, okay? This is how we know that this is something that is being led by a spirit of error, okay? All right, continuing forth, okay, so it's sensual, it is devilish, and devilish is daimonides, okay? It means demon-like, demonic, okay? So it is devilish, for where envying and strife is, there is confusion and every evil work. Okay? These doctrines promote envying and strife and confusion, okay? And they're in that place, up under that type of sensual doctrine, okay? There is going to be every evil work. Okay? But the wisdom that is from above, you see, the Lord always draws the line in the sand. He makes his word very clear to those who would endeavor to seek him out. Amen. Praise God. So he says, but the wisdom that is from above is first pure. Praise God. Then peaceable, gentle, and easy to be entreated. Praise God. Full of mercy and good fruits, without partiality. You see, the Lord has no respecter of persons. Has no respect of persons, and without hypocrisy. And the fruit of righteousness is sown in peace of them that make peace. Okay? All right? So he makes a distinction in between that which the Spirit of truth would lead and guide us into. Praise God, the way of God, the way of love, the doctrine of Christ, okay? And that in and of itself makes it very plain. The Holy Spirit of truth always reveals to us the Christ. It is called the doctrine of Christ. Praise God, okay? Versus the spirit of error that would lead and guide us into the ways of seduction, okay? That which is earthly, sensual, and devilish. That which encourages the way of the flesh, okay? All right, so, and also we are warned of these things in 2 John chapter 1 and verse number 7. Again, that's the great book of 2 John chapter 1 and verse number 7, where the great word of God does read, "For many deceivers are entered into the world," okay, "who confess not that Jesus Christ is come in the flesh. This is a deceiver and an antichrist," okay? So he makes it very plain that these people are not just coming, okay? They have already come, okay? Deception, deceivers have been in the world, praise God, almost, well, I was going to say since the beginning, really, I mean, because Satan was really already here in the earth, okay? Satan and the fallen angels and things of that nature, they were already here. That's why, you know, as Pastor Harris has shared with us in times past, the Lord did not call the atmosphere good, okay? And it's because the father of lies was already here. God bless you. Praise God. All right. But the word of God ever warns us that this is already here. This is why the word of God tells us to try the spirits by the Spirit, by the Holy Spirit. Amen. Praise God. We have to make sure that the Spirit of truth is the one that's leading and guiding us into the revelation of the Christ and not the other way around. Praise God. And we find over in the great book of Revelation, chapter 12, and verse number 9, again, that's the great book of Revelation, chapter 12, and verse number 9, the great word of God tells us that the great dragon was cast out, that old serpent called the devil and Satan, which deceiveth the whole world, okay? So for those of us who would think that maybe somebody else was deceived and we ourselves had not been deceived, the word of God is very clear, okay? He tells us all have sinned and come short of the glory of God, okay? He tells us that anything that the father of lies gives us or tells us is in that spirit of error, okay? It is always going to be in a way of deception, okay? So he says, and the great dragon was cast out, that old serpent called the devil and Satan, which deceiveth the whole world. He was cast out into the earth, and his angels were cast out with him, okay? So for all those of us who claim to be seeing all these molten angels and things with wings that are falling all over the place and things of that nature, okay, speaking these doctrines of demons and doctrines of devils, okay, these familiar spirits and all these type of spirit guides and all this type of thing, this is not of God. Amen. These are spirits of error, okay? These are demonic doctrines of demons and devils, okay? These are seducing spirits that have come to draw us out of the way of God, okay? Just as the serpent beguiled Eve in the garden, okay? She was deceived, okay? She was deceived by the doctrine of the dragon, okay? The doctrine of the serpent. The same holds true today. That's the whole goal of the enemy is to get us out of the way of the true and the living God, because God is our source of life, okay? And once we get over into that law of sin, okay, attached to that is death. The law of sin and death, okay? So both he and his angels were cast out, those angels that followed him, speaking lies in hypocrisy. Excuse me, that we've gone back to verse 2, forgive me, of 1 Timothy chapter 4. I'm sorry, I should have asked you to hold your place there, but we've gone back to verse 2 of 1 Timothy chapter 4, where he says, speaking lies in hypocrisy, having their conscience seared with a hot iron, okay? So what the devil does, of course, is he always seeks out those who have lived a lifestyle of rejecting the leading and guidance of the Holy Spirit. Those who are akin to the spirit of error. Those who are bound in selfishness, okay? Those who are bound in the lust of their flesh because they have become so accustomed to this that it does not even bother them any longer to lie and to act out that which the enemy encourages them to act out, okay? And they constantly fleece the sheep of God. They constantly lead the children of God astray, okay? They are agents of the devil, okay? They are not agents of God, okay? They appear pious and holy, okay? But this is why, once again, we have to try the Spirit by the Spirit, because otherwise, if we do not, we will be beguiled as Eve was, and we will lose it all. We will lose access to the life source, okay? So for the sake of time, at this point, we're going to go ahead and leave off there. I thank you all very much for joining us on this night. We will pick back up on next week. But at this time, if you would please be so kind as to stand with me, we're going to go before the Lord once again in prayer, and we're going to close out for this night. Now, of course, if that anything that I have said on this night or that Pastor Harris has said during the Sunday services has been a blessing unto you, we ask that you would please be so kind as to like and to subscribe and to click on the little bell down below there so that you will be sure to receive notifications each time a new message comes forth, okay? And you can join along with us, praise God, and let the Lord use you in your comments down below as well. And if the Lord lead and guide you into doing so, please be sure to also click on the Cash App there. We ask that you would please support us in both prayer, first and foremost, praise God, as well as in your finances if the Lord would lead you to do so, because I assure you that this is, in fact, good ground. It is fertile ground, praise God. And we are believing the Lord to take the gospel, praise God, all over the world that he would have us to take it into, praise God. So glory be to God. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Praise your holy name, Most High. Heavenly Father, in the mighty name of Jesus, we come before you yet again on this night. We are ever so grateful to you, O Lord God, for who you are and for all that you've done. Though if we had 10,000 tongues, we could never ever thank you enough, O Lord God. Nonetheless, we endeavor with all that is within us, O Lord God, to thank you and to praise you and to reverence you, Most High, and to worship you, O Lord God, because we know that the fear of the Lord, O Lord God, is the beginning of wisdom. It is the beginning of knowledge. It is the beginning of life, O Lord God. It is that which protects our life, O Lord God. And Heavenly Father, we reverence you in this house. We reverence you in this place, O God. Heavenly Father, in the mighty name of Jesus, we thank you for the word that you sent forth on this night. We pray, O Lord God, that your word would not go forth and fall on deaf ground, on deaf ears, O Lord God, but that your word would go forth and produce that which you have sent them to produce, O Lord God. Heavenly Father, in the mighty name of Jesus, we pray, O Lord God, that you will continue to bless and prosper this ministry, O Lord God, both spiritually, Lord God, and holistically, O Lord God. We ask for your healing hand, O Lord God, to be mighty upon this house. In the mighty name of Jesus, O Lord God, we pray, O Lord God, that you would ever continue to order our steps in your great word, O Lord God. Help us to ever be surrendered with all our heart, with all our minds, with all our soul unto you, Lord Jesus, and you alone. Help us to place our and keep our all on the altar, O Lord God of sacrifice, ever rejecting the altar of convenience, O Lord God. Heavenly Father, in the mighty name of Jesus, help us to not seduce ourselves. Help us not to seduce others. Help us not to be seduced by these seducing spirits, nor by the spirit of error, O Lord God, but help us to only follow the spirit of truth, O Lord God, that leadeth and guideth us into all truth, into knowing the one who is the truth, the way, and the life. In the mighty name of Jesus, O Lord God, we pray that you would give us peace. Peace in our hearts, peace in our homes, peace on our jobs, O Lord God, peace in this great land of America, oh Lord God. Peace in every place, oh Lord God. Heavenly Father, for those who are out there suffering, oh Lord God, at the hand of the enemy, oh God. For those who are being persecuted, oh Lord God, for trying to be free, for trying to seek the one who gives liberty. Heavenly Father, we pray your hand of protection be mighty upon them, oh Lord God, that you would lead them out, oh Lord God, out of the house of bondage, oh Lord God, out of the land of darkness, oh Lord God, into thy marvelous light. In the mighty name of Jesus, oh Lord God, let them be encouraged, oh Lord God. Let them know that you love them, oh Lord God, and that you will be with them even if they make their bed in hell, oh Lord God. Stir them, oh Lord God, and help them. Give them peace, oh Lord God, even in the midst of their storm. Peace that surpasseth all understanding. Heavenly Father, in the mighty name of Jesus, oh Lord God, we pray that you continue to bless and watch over and protect President Donald Trump, oh Lord God, and his wife and his family, oh Lord God, and their household, oh Lord God, and all those who are in places of authority, oh Lord God, who are seeking your face, oh Lord God, who are trying to do things the right way, God's way. Heavenly Father, protect them and watch over them and keep them, oh Lord God, in the mighty name of Jesus, oh Lord God. For those who are not saved, we pray that you would save and deliver them, oh Lord God. Draw them forth into out of darkness, oh Lord God, into thy marvelous light. In the mighty name of Jesus, oh Lord God, we pray that there be peace, oh Lord God, in Jerusalem, prosperity in Jerusalem, oh Lord God. For those who are Jewish, oh Lord God, who do not actually know the Christ, Lord Jesus, reveal yourself unto them, O Lord God. Holy Spirit of truth, lead and guide them into all truth, O Lord God. Give them yet another chance that they may accept the Lord Jesus for who you truly are. Heavenly Father, we bind the hand of deception that will come against your people, O Lord God, that will come against all the people of this world, O Lord God. We ask that you would set the captives free. In the mighty name of Jesus. Help those of us, O Lord God, who do know you, to wake up. Help us to pray without ceasing, O Lord God. Help us to draw nigh unto you, that you may draw nigh unto us, O Lord God. Heavenly Father, even as you stand at the door and you knock, O Lord God, help us to open the door unto you, that you may come in and sup with us, O Lord God. In the mighty name of Jesus, teach us to ever abideth in you. Help us to ever let your word abideth in us, in our hearts, O Lord God. Help us to hide, as David did, the word, your word in our hearts, that we may not sin against thee, O Lord. In the mighty name of Jesus, O Lord, we pray that your continued blessings be upon every service, O Lord God, of your house. We pray that the anointing would go forth and break every burden and every yoke, O Lord God. In the mighty name of Jesus, O Lord God, set the captives free. Let it all be done for your glory and for your great name's sake. This we ask and we pray in the mighty, majestic, and holy name of Jesus. To God be all the glory for who you are and for all that you have done. Amen, amen, amen. Praise God.